Okay, this little lecture is going to cover the financial definition for interest. This is something extremely important for our economy, and it's extremely important that you understand what interest is. As with all of our financial definitions, the most important thing is we need you to make sure that you're using a financial definition and not just a general English definition of a word. You may have interest in your neighbor, in the person sitting next to you, but that's not the kind of interest we're talking about. We're talking about a rental fee paid for the use of money. And what I've got on the screen here is a graphic on borrowers and savers. So you see over here we have savers and investors, and over here we have prime mortgage borrowers. This is for mortgage loans, but it could work for any kind of lending. Basically what you have is there's some people who have too much money and they need to store it. Rather than stuff it in their mattress, they look for a way to earn a return, to invest that money, with the hopes of earning more money. They're not doing it out of the goodness of their hearts. They're doing it because they want to get the money they invest plus some back. That's the rental fee paid for the use of their money. So a bank or a mortgage originator would be a financial intermediary. It's going to take money from savers and investors, bundle it up, and then lend it to borrowers. What's important that in this system is that the people who borrow the money actually pay it back. If most of the money isn't paid back, this entire graphic falls apart. So interest is extremely important because if there's no rental fee paid for the use of money, then investors have no incentive to put their money at risk. Why not just stuff it underneath a mattress? Well, banks and mortgage originators, other lenders are extremely important. They're using other people's money. They have to make sure they lend it to the best people possible and get the best rate. The U.S. has a free market. The world is a free market economy. And this means that savers and investors are not told by the government where to put their money, and the government does not tell lenders who to lend money to. Everyone is working in their own best interest, and by everyone working in their own best interest, we will reach market equilibrium, and the most worthy people will get use of the money. I've got a site to the Dallas Federal Reserve, their website. That's where I got this graphic. So what factors affect the nominal rate of interest? And nominal rate of interest is what we call that rate of interest that you see in the market. We compare different rates of interest that are advertised. You might see terms like APR, annual percentage rate. That's a government-defined way of calculating the interest, but nominal rate of interest is the APR, or the rate charged in the market. But there's a lot of different factors that affect interest. If you just define interest and say a rental fee for money, it's not wrong, but you're not going anywhere near in depth that I expect a college student to go into when they're defining financial terms. So what factors affect the nominal rate of interest? Well, first one is going to be inflation. That's not anything that any of us can do anything about. That's just the investors' perceptions on what is going to happen. Even though average inflation over the last 100 years is about 3.5% in the U.S., if the investors, people who are saving money, think it's going to be a lot higher, they're going to want a much higher rate of interest, a much higher rate of return on their money. Default risk. This is where reputation matters. That's one of the principles of finance. Not every borrower has the same default risk. If you're going to lend money to someone who's got plenty of it, they're a lot less likely to default than someone who doesn't have any other collateral. Also, you think of you as an individual, where are you at a greater default risk? If you buy a house, if you don't pay the loan, well then the bank can come and take the house and hopefully cover the amount of the loan. But if it's just a credit card, you can walk away and there's nothing that the bank can necessarily seize. So default risk goes to the person and also to the individual loan. If it's a loan for something securitized, like a mortgage, default risk will be lower. If it's like a credit card that is not securitized, then the interest rate will be higher. And again, comparing it, person A to person B. If person A has gone bankrupt before, and person B has a stellar credit history, the default risk is going to be higher for person A, and they're going to have a higher rate of interest charged to them than person B. Third factor here is maturity risk. That goes to the length of the loan. If a loan is for a longer period of time, the theory is that there will have to be a premium paid because the person who's lending the money is going to be without their money for a longer period of time. And I put a site here for the Wikipedia entry for the yield curve. That's something you may have heard of. But the yield curve is a graph that shows that demonstrates maturity risk, that interest rates are lower for shorter maturity of loans and higher for longer maturity of loans. The last factor is liquidity risk. The intermediary, and if we would go back to the previous slide, the intermediary is the bank or the mortgage originator. Are they going to be able to sell your loan? Are they going to be able to get their money faster if they'd like to? Think of if the bank or the mortgage originator has had someone like Ginny Mae or Fannie Mae buy the loans from them and securitize them, then they have they're able to liquidate that loan. They're able to sell the loan to someone else and get their cash. So the ability to quickly sell a loan if you would need to and get your money back is an important factor in loans or in borrowing. As an individual, if you would buy a government bond, that would be if you ever wanted to get your money back, you wouldn't have to wait till the maturity date. You could sell that government bond to someone else. There's an actively traded market. But if you'd loaned the money to your neighbor Sam and you wanted to get the money back before the maturity date of the loan, and Sam didn't want to give you the money back, you'd have a hard time selling that individual loan. So liquidity is another factor that affects inflation. So think of all these different factors when you're coming up with your definition. Remember, I expect at least three sentences defining the term. You see here, you could write several paragraphs on just the information I've presented in this short lecture. And then I want one sentence on how you personally relate to the term. So thank you, study hard, and I'll see you in class.